lectures on the basic structure of the events that happen during wound healing. And I left off when we got to the formation of scars. But since there's a lot of new people here today, I thought I'd give a little introduction again, which might be a repeat for some of you, just to make sure that everybody's on the same page.
Ieri la mia presentazione si è concentrata soprattutto sulle strutture di base degli eventi legati alla riparazione tissutale. Ci siamo concentrati anche sulla formazione delle cicatrici. Vorrei quindi ridarvi una piccola introduzione di quello che è stato detto ieri.
So the model system that we use to probe the cellular and molecular basis of wound healing, as well as the diseases that arise when the same processes become deregulated, is the skin. And just for a brief background, the skin is primarily, you can think of it as two different compartments, an upper layer of epithelial cells comprising the epidermis. It's contiguous with the hair follicle and the sebaceous gland. So the epidermis, sebaceous gland, and hair follicle all come from one, the same progenitor cells. And in the afternoon lecture, I'll talk about the biogenesis of the hair follicle and how the formation of this structure can teach us about tissue regeneration. But what I'm going to talk about today is tissue repair. And so going back to the anatomy of the skin, the epidermis is the top layer that forms the barrier function of the tissue. And beneath it is the dermis, which is primarily extracellular matrix produced by fibroblasts that are within the within this compartment. And the major function, as I mentioned, of the skin is the barrier from the external environment. So it prevents infection, protects from physical damage, as well as the loss of excess water. And because it has this barrier function and it's the interface with the environment, it has frequent damage to it. So it has been evolved the mechanism to rapidly repair itself to restore that barrier function. And so that's what makes this system a prime model system to understand the events that occur during wound healing, because it's basically a professional wound healing tissue.
Ieri abbiamo parlato del sistema di modello utilizzato nel campo della riparazione tissutale e delle malattie e ci siamo concentrati proprio sulla pelle, quindi vorrei darvi qualche piccolo spunto su questo argomento. Abbiamo visto che la pelle è formata soprattutto da due diverse parti, ci siamo poi spostati sull'analisi della pelle, quindi l'epidermide, i follicoli, le varie ghiandole, e abbiamo visto come i follicoli abbiano una formazione che è legata alla rigenerazione dei tessuti. Vorrei quindi parlarvi di riparazione dei tessuti, così come abbiamo discusso già ieri. L'epidermide è considerata come una barriera la funzione principale della pelle è proprio questa, quella di essere una sorta di barriera dai pericoli esterni, dall'ambiente esterno, in modo da prevenire quindi infezioni di ogni genere. Il sistema, quindi ci concentreremo anche oggi sul sistema sulla funzione appunto di barriera da parte della pelle.
Okay. So, as a basic context, the wound healing program has been classically divided into three separate but overlapping and interdependent phases. So the first phase is the inflammatory response, where you have the recruitment of immune cells into the tissue to fight off the infection because the barrier is broken. The second phase is the proliferative phase. It's quite complex, but yesterday I talked about how you can control the proliferation of skin stem cells, so you need more of the building blocks to rebuild the tissue. As well as new blood vessel formation and the migration of cells actually to close the gap within the tissue. And then finally, you have your remodeling phase where you have changes in cell-cell and cell-ECM interactions. And this can actually last up to many years. And to a large extent, I'm going to be focusing today's talk on this step of the wound healing process. And As I illustrated yesterday, they're independent phases, but there's a lot of crosstalk that occurs between the cells associated with each phase. So for instance, I showed you yesterday some data where the immune cells, in particular the gamma delta T cells in the epidermis, can induce the proliferation of hair follicle stem cells to help them promote wound healing. And what I'm going to talk about today is how the changes in the extracellular matrix can feed back and impact the inflammatory response in the tissue. I'm going to talk about two proteins that do that today. The one is called myndin, and the other is fibrillin 5. And at the center of this ECM, the extracellular matrix, are the dermal fibroblasts. Okay. And largely these, you know, in the context of the tissue, have largely been overlooked, because essentially what they thought they do is basically these fibroblasts just secrete the collagen that is the major component of this tissue, right? So collagen can make up 25 to 30% of the entire content of the protein. So these fibroblasts can actually secrete out a lot of ECM. So some of the work that we're doing now is the mechanism by which you can control collagen secretion by these fibroblasts, as well as what is the function of this ECM in terms of maintaining tissue homeostasis.
Allora, il programma legato alla riparazione tessutale viene definito in due fasi differenti che abbiamo visto nella slide precedente. Una è la risposta infiammatoria, poi c'è la proliferazione legata alle cellule staminali, alla migrazione delle cellule, e infine il remodeling, che è una fase che può durare anche molti anni. Oggi mi concentrerò sul processo di riparazione tessutale, che è costituito appunto da queste fasi che sono indipendenti. Vedremo le cellule T nell'epidermide che aiutano proprio la promozione della riparazione tessutale. Mi concentrerò su due proteine
differenti vi parlerò anche dei fibroblasti, di quanto siano legati alla secrezione di collagene. Un dato che posso fornirvi è che il 25-30% circa dell'intero contenuto delle proteine è formato proprio dal collagene, quindi vedremo anche la funzione dell'ECM legata sempre alla riparazione tessutale.
Then they start secreting extracellular matrix to form a scaffold in order to allow the cells to migrate over the wound area, as well as to recruit other cells into this area. So in addition to the excess secretion of ECM, these fibroblasts, once they're activated, they start expressing this protein, smooth muscle actin. So they start expressing this protein, smooth muscle actin. And what that smooth muscle actin does is it allows these cells to pull on the extracellular matrix that they've deposited. And then it almost has a purse string. They start pulling it, and you can close the wound by contraction, right? So in addition to the keratinocytes migrating over this open bed, the fibroblast also will contract it so that the wound size is also smaller. So you have two things that are trying to actually close the wound as quickly as possible. So they play an important role in a physiological response. But in addition to that, they actually, in certain cases, become hyperactive. So essentially, when the fibroblasts are done with their job in wound healing, they either die or become quiescent. In certain diseases, such as fibrosis, there's a failure to inactivate these activated fibroblasts. And what happens is that you secrete a large amount of ECM, and that causes basically fibrosis or hardening of the tissue, which ultimately leads to organ failure. Okay. And in the context of cancer, these activated fibroblasts are called carcinoma-associated fibroblasts, and they play an important role in the tumor stroma. They have been seen to actually be able to recruit the immune cells that are associated with the tumor, as well as to signal to the tumor itself to proliferate and then to migrate. So together with tissue fibrosis and tumor stroma, fibrotic diseases account for 1/3 of all deaths worldwide. So it's important to be able to understand not only how these are activated, but then how do you inactivate them in order to avoid these three different these kind of diseases.
La domanda che ci poniamo è perché dovremmo porre attenzione su questi fibroblasti che vengono attivati. Quando avviene questo processo, i fibroblasti reclutano anche altre aree all'interno dell'area che abbiamo visto, altre cellule, scusate, all'interno dell'area che abbiamo visto nella slide precedente. I fibroblasti quindi riescono anche a chiudere in qualche modo la ferita attraverso la contrazione. E questo viene fatto nella maniera più veloce possibile, e quindi vediamo proprio quanto sia importante il ruolo nella risposta fisiologica da parte dei fibroblasti. A volte possono diventare anche iperattivi e in alcune malattie come quelle legate alla fibrosi avviene anche la secrezione di molto ECM. Nel cancro tutto questo è associato alla formazione di carcinoma. E vediamo infine un ultimo dato, che un terzo circa delle morti in tutto il mondo è legato proprio alla fibrosi.
Okay, so here's just some figure that shows the presence of these activated fibroblasts in both physiological, such as wounds, and pathological conditions. So as I mentioned, during wound healing, the fibroblasts, through different mechanisms, are activated, and then they contract the wound and also deposit ECM. In a normal response, this is required for normal scarring, but then if it's excessive, you get hypertrophic scarring, or this over-scarring. And this is an image of this, what occurs. So in red is keratin 14, which marks the epidermis of the skin. And smooth muscle actin, again, is a marker of the activated fibroblast. So the wound is around here, and you can see that near the wound site, the fibroblasts are becoming activated, okay? If you look at a squamous cell carcinoma of the skin, you almost see the exact same thing, an activation of the fibroblast in the context of skin cancer. Just an exaggerated form of what you see during wound healing, right? So the idea then is that if we could understand the processes that occurred in wound healing, we'll also hopefully get some insight into what is going wrong in cancer. And so we originally got onto this project by the question that we see here. So in human skins, many of you have seen that when you get a cut, you get what's called a hypertrophic scar. Right, so the scar is somewhat elevated from the surface of your tissue. When you wound a mouse, which we did here, so we made an excisional wound on the back skin of the mouse, you can see that it heals relatively cleanly. Right, you don't see any of this kind of scar tissue, and actually the hair is able to form back. So many of you guys have seen when you guys have a cut where the hair normally grows, after the cut and scar formation, you usually don't get hair formation. But part of it's due to the fact that the ECM is blocking the excessive scar tissue is blocking the formation of the hair follicle. So the question that we had is that why do humans scar but not mice, right? And why can't we scar like this? Why can't we heal like this? Why do we heal like this if this can be problematic? So what we did was that we looked at various literatures and what is the differences at the gene level between human skin and mouse skin. And what we found was that there was one gene that is expressed in human skin that's not expressed in mouse skin. I don't know, can you turn down the light a little? The light? Oh, that's it? Oh, okay. Sorry, Mr. Ok, go ahead. She'll translate while they do that.
Allora, i primi numeri, i primi dati che vorrei darvi riguardano proprio la presenza di fibroblasti attivati che, come abbiamo detto precedentemente, si occupano di contrarre le ferite. La cicatrizzazione delle ferite può essere normale, ma può essere anche ipertrofica. Abbiamo visto già ieri un progetto in cui ci si è focalizzati sulla cicatrizzazione sulla pelle umana e la cicatrizzazione invece sulla pelle di topi. Quindi sono stati fatti diversi esperimenti, si è visto come nei topi la cicatrizzazione sia normale, mentre negli umani sia di tipo ipertrofico. Negli umani vediamo inoltre che non c'è ricrescita di follicoli, ricrescita di peli nella pelle e quindi la domanda che ci facciamo è perché nel corpo umano la cicatrizzazione avviene in questo modo a differenza di quello che invece succede negli esperimenti sui topi.
So, there's different genes expression in the human skin versus the mouse skin. So we were asking, is any of these differences responsible for the different types of wound healing that you get? And so we tested one of these, which is this protein called SNAIL that is expressed in human skin but not in mouse skin. So if we overexpress the SNAIL in the mouse skin, what you can see, well, trust me, is that you're getting scar formation here, similar to what you have here. And unlike the normal mouse, you're not getting hair follicle formation back upon wound healing. So essentially, we were able to make the mouse wound heal like the human one with, in terms of scar formation, just by expressing this transcription factor SNAIL. Okay? So SNAIL actually is a well-known transcription factor. Primarily studied in early embryological development, where it mediates what's known as an epithelial to mesenchymal transition, right? So the epithelial cells lose their epithelial characteristics and become more like mesenchymal cells, meaning that they can proliferate and migrate faster. So it's not surprising then that you see it playing roles where you have a lot of cell migration, such as the primitive streak formation during the mesoderm, and in neural crest delamination, when you have the neural crest forming and the delaminating cells during embryogenesis. Now, this is primarily what its function is in early embryogenesis, but it's been also found to be a possible contributor to tumorigenesis, okay? So you have these epithelial cells that can, when you transfect with SNAIL, look like invasive mesenchymal cells, that like they're almost metastatic. And in vivo, what people have found is that in tumor cells that have early metastasis, the invasive cells are the ones that express SNAIL. Okay, so this correlates with what's seen in embryogenesis, that the expression of SNAIL causes more a migratory phenotype of the cells. And this is actually, SNAIL has been gaining a lot of attention because it's very widespread in the expression of various epithelial cancers or carcinomas. So you can see that it's been reported in breast cancer, ovarian, gastric, esophagus, stomach, colon cancers, and head and neck squamous cell carcinomas. And again, this review is kind of old, and almost every epithelial cancer has now been reported to have SNAIL expressed. But to a large extent, the contribution of SNAIL to these cancers is not known. And it's been correlated that SNAIL expression is thought to be a good diagnostic marker for the poor prognosis or the likelihood of relapse of cancer cells. Okay, so I'll skip this part. Go ahead.
Allora, la diversa cicatrizzazione è dovuta alla diversità di geni presenti nel corpo umano e nel corpo invece di topi. Abbiamo esaminato il ruolo di questa proteina particolare, SNAIL, all'interno della pelle umana e quindi abbiamo visto come questa possa influire sulla formazione delle cicatrici. Nelle foto precedenti abbiamo visto la cicatrizzazione nei topi che che attraverso diversi esperimenti, diciamo, è avvenuta come avviene in realtà all'interno del corpo umano, e lo snail è stato studiato più che altro a livello embriologico. Abbiamo visto come le cellule dell'epitelio possano proliferare molto velocemente. Nella slide precedente c'era una lista di diversi studi, diversi trattati che sono stati fatti su questo argomento e che hanno dato sicuramente un grosso contributo all'identificazione e alla genesi dei tumori. Per quanto riguarda i test in vivo, abbiamo visto quanto nelle cellule tumorali l'espressione della snail possa causare la migrazione delle cellule. È stato anche visto che in realtà la maggior parte dei carcinoma è stata già studiata, quindi sono già stati fatti diversi approfondimenti sull'argomento. Tuttavia, però, la proteina snail si lega a una prognosi piuttosto scarsa, e questo è un dato importante che abbiamo trovato.
Okay, so I'm going to skip through some of the introductory slides. And so how we decided to try to understand the role of snail is we did an overexpression gain of function study by overexpressing snail in the epidermis, where it's normally not expressed, because it's normally expressed in the hair follicle. And essentially the mouse looked like this one, where you have hyperproliferation of the epidermis, a stunted growth, and a loss of hair follicle formation. I'm not going through most of the phenotype because I talked about this yesterday, but I wanted to get to the point of this. Okay, so I told you that we're initially interested in the fibroblasts and how does snail cause the mouse to form a scar, hypertrophic scar, when it normally doesn't. And at the center of the scar formation, as I mentioned, is the fibroblast. So an activated fibroblast, as I showed before, has the expression of the smooth muscle actin. And relative to the unactivated fibroblast, this activated fibroblast secretes a large amount of extracellular matrix proteins, a lot of ECM. And then it changes the morphologies as it can contract the tissue. So the question that we had is the snail transgenic mouse causing the activation of this fibroblast, right? And primarily we're looking by the expression of this protein, smooth muscle actin, which is present in the activated fibroblast but not in the unactivated fibroblast. And as you can see here, we did immunohistochemistry in a normal wild-type mouse. In this case, here's the epidermis here, and then this is the dermis, and these are where the fibroblasts should be. And you don't see much smooth muscle actin staining, so not much activated fibroblast in a normal mouse. If you see in a snail transgenic mouse, the epidermis is thickened, it's here. And you can see these brown dots are all activated fibroblasts, okay? So the expression of snail transgenic, the snail transgene in this mouse can activate these dermal fibroblasts. And consistent with this marker of activation, what we found relative to the wild type, where the epidermis is in red with K5 and collagen is in green, you can see that the snail transgenic mouse has much more collagen deposition relative to its wild type. And if you look at other extracellular matrix proteins such as fibronectin, again, there's a marked increase in the amount of ECM produced in the snail transgenic mouse relative to its wild type component. Okay?
Vorrei fare un'introduzione più veloce delle diapositive che abbiamo visto ieri. Volevo concentrarmi tuttavia sulla comprensione del ruolo dello snail. Nel topo vediamo un'alta proliferazione a livello dell'epidermide. Vado avanti velocemente su alcune diapositive. Abbiamo visto che nei fibroblasti la snail è legata alla cicatrizzazione di tipo ipertrofico. Ci siamo concentrati sulle caratteristiche dei fibroblasti attivati in contrasto con i fibroblasti non attivati. Quelli attivati secernono molto ECM e questo porta a una contrazione dei tessuti. Abbiamo visto poi che c'è una proteina particolare all'interno della categoria dei fibroblasti attivati che in realtà non è presente nei fibroblasti non attivati. Nei topi transgenici abbiamo visto delle macchie marroni che proprio sono legate a questa differenza. In questa slide vediamo l'epidermide in rosso e il collagene in verde. Nei topi transgenici la produzione di collagene è maggiore, cioè più collagene proprio dovuto anche all'aumento di ECM prodotto.
Okay. So what we can also see in the snail transgenic mouse is this bar measures the dermal thickness. So relative to the wild type skin, the dermis in the snail transgenic mouse is markedly increased, again due to the overactivation of the fibroblasts, which are depositing a large amount of extracellular matrix proteins. Okay, so I've been throughout these lectures trying to link the wound healing with cancer and some other diseases. And it's like I mentioned, there's various examples of how snail is expressed in different carcinomas and different cancers. And there is actually a fibrotic skin disease known as scleroderma. And what we did is that in collaboration with the John Vargas lab at Northwestern University, we got skins from normal and scleroderma patients and looked for snail expression. And as you can see in the normal skin, snail is a transcription factor, so it should be in the nucleus. And there is no snail, nuclear snail in the normal tissue. But what you can see in the scleroderma tissue is that there's nuclear snail in the basal layer of the epidermis. And this is actually by luck quite interesting because this is the same place where we targeted the snail in the mouse, our mouse transgenic model. Okay, so our mouse model is expressing this protein snail in the same place where it's found in the human scleroderma tissue. So the question that becomes quite interesting is that we're expressing snail in the epidermis, right here, but it's the dermal fibroblasts that are becoming activated. So what is the mechanism by which snail expressed in one compartment of the tissue activates fibroblasts in a different compartment, right? So the, should I ask you the question? So the major dogma in the field, and again, it's due to the role of snail during embryonic development, is that snail-expressing keratinocytes undergo an epithelial to mesenchymal transition, right? And that these fibroblasts are a product of that EMT. So the activated fibroblasts are from the snail-expressing epithelial cells, right? So if you read reviews, they'll always invoke this idea of EMT as the mechanism by which you generate these activated fibroblasts. So we went and tested this hypothesis using a lineage tracing experiment. So what we did is we marked the stem cells of the epithelial compartment of the skin in blue. So anything that gave rise was given rise or originated from the epithelial stem cells will be blue. So you have your epidermis is going to be blue, the hair follicle, and then the sebaceous gland are blue because they all derive from the same stem cells. Okay. Now the question is that if snail expression in the keratinocytes are responsible for these activated fibroblasts, we should see blue dots in the transgenic skin, but we don't. So in brown is this label for the activated fibroblast for the smooth muscle actin. And you can see that none of these activated fibroblasts are blue, suggesting that they did not come from the epithelial compartment. This is a non-EMT event. You didn't get that?
Sorry?
Oh, you look confused.
No.
Okay. You want to repeat?
No.
Go ahead.
Allora, abbiamo visto nelle slide precedente lo snail nel topo transgenico.
You shouldn't sit up front. Oh, sorry, go ahead. Go ahead.
con un aumento dello spessore dell'epidermide, quindi vediamo come la pelle risulti essere più spessa, abbiamo visto nella slide in viola. Ci sono diversi esempi di come questo si esprima in diverse tipologie di cancro. Ci siamo concentrati anche ieri su una malattia, una patologia particolare, lo scleroderma, e abbiamo visto proprio in questa l'espressione della SNAIL, che è molto interessante per quanto riguarda l'aspetto legato ai tessuti. Quindi a questo punto la domanda che ci poniamo è quale sia il meccanismo di attivazione dei fibroblasti nelle diverse aree all'interno dei tessuti. I fibroblasti attivati sono legati al meccanismo dell'EMT, abbiamo visto anche l'importanza delle cellule staminali. Proprio in questo campo. Abbiamo visto nelle slide precedenti delle macchie blu, diciamo, che sono proprio legate ai fibroblasti nella pelle dei topi transgenici. Non troviamo in realtà questi fibroblasti in quest'ultima slide.
Okay, so I asked the question I asked yesterday, but you don't have to answer. For the undergrad or the students, if you are expressing SNAIL in the epidermis, how do they talk to the fibroblasts in the dermis? What would be one mechanism by which this communication can be accomplished? So I already showed you data that these keratinocytes are not becoming the fibroblasts. So it suggests that the activated fibroblasts are being activated in a different manner. What would one manner be by which they can communicate with each other?
La domanda che ho fatto anche ieri, che vorrei porre agli studenti che sono presenti qui oggi, come avviene secondo voi la comunicazione tra l'epidermide e il derma?
If no one answers, I'll pick one out. You can tell them.
Se nessuno risponde, vi picchia.
Oh, look, microphone. Yeah, him.
I have no idea.
Can you guess? Guess.
Puoi indovinare, puoi provare a tentare. Sto pensando.
Okay. Anybody else want to help think? Diffusion of what?
Chemotactic system. Transmission of signal.
Correct. One simple hypothesis is that these SNAIL-expressing keratinocytes are secreting an extracellular protein that can diffuse to the fibroblasts and activate them, right? So that's the most straightforward hypothesis if it's not an EMT. So we went and tested that hypothesis itself. So what we did is we grew the keratinocytes from the normal mice and from the SNAIL transgenic mouse. And essentially what we did is that we cultured them and then let them secrete whatever protein that they produce. And what you can do is condition the media with that protein. So you collect this conditioned media that has all the secreted proteins and put that onto another plate with dermal fibroblasts, right? So all you're doing is exchanging the media from one plate to the other and asking, can that secreted factors that are in this media activate this fibroblast? Okay?
Un'ipotesi è legata proprio a quello che diceva lo studente in fondo. Abbiamo cercato di esaminare questa ipotesi legandoci all'aspetto dei cheratinociti, e abbiamo visto proprio come avviene questo scambio all'interno del media.
Okay, so there's two ways we can test to see if these dermal fibroblasts are activated. Paolo, what are the two ways we can test for dermal fibroblast activation?
Quali sono i modi in cui esaminiamo l'attivazione di questi fibroblasti?
It was in the introduction.
Era nell'introduzione.
But I was sleeping.
No, I was here.
Okay.
And
Form, secretion, and form.
Okay, that's this guy. Who is this guy?
Chi sei?
Okay, so there's, like I said, the activated fibroblasts change their form and can contract collagen, right? So we could measure that activity. So what you do is you get fibroblasts and mix it with collagen and solidify the collagen into a plug. And then, so you have a plug of collagen with fibroblasts embedded. As a positive control, you can treat it with TGF-beta-2, and that can activate fibroblasts. And what it'll do is pull the plug, contract the plug, so that's why the diameter gets very small relative to the control. Okay, so this is an assay for measuring the contraction of the fibroblasts. And what we did is we treated with wild-type skin media versus the media from the snail transgenic skin. And when you quantify it, you have your untreated here. TGF-beta is our positive control, where you can get about 60% of the gel to contract. When you add the snail transgenic condition media, you can get about a 40% contraction, which suggests that the snail expressing keratinocytes are secreting something to activate the fibroblasts and cause them to contract. So the second way of testing this is actually the expression of these markers, smooth muscle actin and connected tissue growth factor, right? And you can see when we add wild-type conditioned media or snail transgenic conditioned media, both the connective tissue growth factor and the smooth muscle actin expression are highly upregulated in when the cells are treated with the media from the snail transgenic keratinocytes.
Abbiamo visto il legame che esiste, il legame esistente tra i fibroblasti attivati e il collagene, quindi vediamo che avviene proprio una solidificazione del collagene e abbiamo visto attraverso esperimenti il trattamento con il TGF beta 2 per misurare proprio la contrazione dei fibroblasti. E abbiamo visto come questa avvenga in diversi livelli. Il secondo modo per esaminare questo procedimento è l'espressione che avviene attraverso il marker che abbiamo visto nella slide precedente.
Okay. So the thing in the field is that I already showed you that TGF-beta 2 can activate the fibroblasts. So the question that people in the field of fibrosis would always ask is the snail keratinocyte secreting TGF-beta 2? And that's what's causing the activation of the fibroblasts. And the answer to that is no, right? So we can add a TGF-beta inhibitor to the snail conditioned media, and it does not block the activation of the fibroblasts. Another common cytokine that's often invoked in fibrosis is IL-1. And if we use the receptor of fibroblasts lacking the receptor to make them insensitive to IL-1 signaling, that also doesn't prevent activation of these fibroblasts. So there is something different produced by the snail transgenic keratinocytes that are capable of activating these fibroblasts. And that's becoming quite important because, again, one of the dogma in the field is that these keratinocytes can secrete TGF-beta or IL-1, and that can lead to the activation of these fibroblasts, right? And there has been a lot of clinical trials targeting both TGF-beta and IL-1 as an anti-fibrotic therapy. Now, the problem with that is that a lot of the clinical trials are failing when you block TGF-beta signaling, okay? So that suggests two things. One is that it's not TGF-beta, or if it is, there's another component there that is also equally important required for this fibrosis. So only blocking one is not enough. So that, you know, adds impetus for us to try to understand what other signaling components are present that can also activate these fibroblasts and perhaps can be used as a, you know, complement to the inhibition studies in these clinical trials to make it more effective.
Abbiamo visto precedentemente come il TGF-beta 2 sia responsabile dell'attivazione di fibroblasti e ci siamo concentrati anche sui cheratinociti che possono secernere TGF-beta 1. Abbiamo visto molti trial clinici in questo ambito. Il problema è che in realtà molti di questi falliscono, quindi non ci consentono di avere delle risposte in materia.
Okay, so then the question is, what is that component that is being secreted from the snail expressing keratinocytes that are activating this fibroblast, right? You ready for another question? Okay, so how would we test whether or not this was a protein or some lipid or metabolite that's being secreted from this keratinocyte? You know this one, right? No. So, I mean, you know, we generally assume it's going to be a protein, but what's an easy test that you can do to test whether or not this is a protein or not?
Qual è un test che si può fare per vedere se in questo caso esiste una proteina responsabile o no?
Here's a hint. Structure equals function. Structure equals function. A hint.
Funzione della struttura.
So we're proposing there's something secreted from these keratinocytes that are activating the fibroblasts. It could be a lipid, could be a metabolite, or it could be a protein. How do I tell if it's a protein?
Which one?
Whatever this is. This is Biochemistry 101.
questa è biochimica 1.
We test before like before with the medium.
Okay, what are you going to do to the medium? So the medium would have lipids, metabolites, proteins.
Which one?
Which is the active one, right?
This component.
Okay, suppose it's a protein.
Si suppone sia una proteina.
How would you prove it?
Come lo proviamo?
How about the professors over there?
I professori lì in fondo forse vogliono dire qualcosa?
Yeah, but that will tell you there's proteins there. It won't tell you if that's the active component, right? It'll tell you the proteins are present, but it won't tell you if those proteins are responsible for the activation.
Vi dice che ci sono le proteine, ma non che siano responsabili dell'attivazione.
There is going to be some difference.
In that case, then you can isolate and
yeah, but do I do?
You can make molecular biology and express somewhere else and.
Or do so? I have to do proteomics versus metabolomics versus lipidomics. Which one do I do?
Non ho capito che what?
Cosa?
But I'm telling you, it's protein. How would I prove it's a protein? A very simple experiment.
Ok, è una proteina, ma come lo provo?
You can digest with a proteolytic, for example.
That's
enzyme.
Good, but also that might, you know, destroy the cells that you put it on the conditioned media, right? So.
Potrebbe distruggere le cellule.
I'll give you a hint. Go outside. What is it?
You switch off, turn off the expression of the gene.
That's yeah, I guess so. But I don't know if it's, I'm just telling you it's protein. I don't know which protein. Okay, this again.
So
it could heat and activate. It's a classic experiment, right? Just heat and activate your conditioned media. Raise it to 95 degrees, and then test if that conditioned media can activate fibroblasts, right? So you denature the protein with heat, right? So that's why I was saying structure equals function.
Si denatura la proteina portandola a una temperatura di 95 gradi.
So basically, you just boil your conditioned media. Can it still activate the fibroblasts? Okay. So
quindi,
we did that experiment. Oh, do you want to say that?
Okay. No, quindi è legato alla temperatura.
Okay. So we did this experiment. We know it's a protein. So then we're going to go do mass spec. Okay. But again, the problem with mass spectrometry is that you get too much data, right? You're going to have tons of different proteins. So what we decided to do again was basically old school biochemistry. Is we just go through a fractionation protocol. So what we did is we took either wild type or snail transgenic conditioned media and then fractionated it on an anion exchange column, okay? And then we asked which of these fractions can cause collagen contraction and induction of CTGF smooth muscle actin. So these are the two assays for activation, right? the contraction of the collagen and the upregulation of these two genes. And then so we narrowed down that fraction to those guys, and then we ran it over another column. And then I guess which of these fractions can activate collagen contraction and induce smooth muscle actin and CTGF. And you know, we went through this before doing mass spec because this narrowed down the amount of proteins that are only found in the snail condition media versus the wild type condition media, and it's been selected for their ability to activate the fibroblasts.
Quindi qual è cos'è questa componente? Ne abbiamo parlato. Possiamo utilizzare la spettrometria di massa. In realtà questo porta a diverse problematiche, quindi ci sono diversi procedimenti come la cromatografia che porta anche a un'analisi della contrazione del collagene. E qui vediamo in questa immagine tutti i diversi procedimenti, i diversi tipi di analisi che possono essere fatti.
Okay, so the two proteins I'm going to talk to you about this morning are spondin 2 and fibulin 5. And what do they do for fibroblast activation? So I'll talk about spondin 2 now. So spondin 2 is not normally expressed in wild type keratinocytes. However, when you express snail, you can turn on the expression of spondin 2. Okay, so this is a differentially regulated gene. It's not present in normal keratinocytes, but when you express snail, it turns on spondin 2 expression. So what is spondin 2? So spondin 2 is also called mindin, right? And this was originally identified in zebrafish. So it's a member of the F spondin family of proteins. It is secreted and has been shown to associate with the extracellular matrix. In zebrafish, it's a component of the basal lamina. And they didn't want to answer any more questions. Okay, and then it's been shown to be a ligand for integrins. Okay. Importantly, it's been suggested to be a pathogen recognition receptor, which is responsible for the production of inflammatory cytokines. And in zebrafish, it's been known to promote hippocampal outgrowth in neurons. So we actually started focusing on this reported function of mindin, its production of inflammatory cytokines, because in the literature, it's well known that signaling from different immune cells, such as eosinophils, macrophages, and neutrophils, can impact fibroblast activation into myofibroblasts. And that can lead to fibrosis.
Vorrei concentrarmi adesso su due proteine differenti, spondin 2 e fibulin 5. La prima, la spondin 2, non si esprime nei cheratociti normali, ma vediamo cos'è questa proteina che è associata all'ECM, fa parte della famiglia dei spondin, è una componente della lamina basale, è considerata anche come un ligando, promuove l'incremento dei neuroni all'interno dell'area dell'ippocampo e abbiamo visto qui la differenza che avviene a seconda delle diverse immunocellule presenti.
Okay, so the hypothesis that we had is that it's possible that mindin on a fibroblast can activate inflammation. So a way of testing this in vitro is that we just isolated primary fibroblasts from the dermis and then stained for this expression of this protein called nuclear factor kappa B. So NF-kappa B, and that's a well-known component mediating the inflammatory response. So in control cells, you can see that NF-kappa B is primarily in the cytoplasm, and that's known. In its inactive form, it's sequestered in the cytoplasm of the cell. When we treat the fibroblasts with mindin or spondin 2, you can see that there's a nuclear translocation of the cytosolic pool into the nucleus of the cell. Okay, so this is one assay for NF-kappa B activation and inflammatory response, that the NF-kappa B translocates from the cytosol into the nucleus of the fibroblasts. And we can also show that these nuclear NF-kappa Bs is active using a transcription assay. So we looked at the known targets, transcriptional targets of NF-kappa B, which is RANTes. And in fibroblasts treated with myodine, you can see that there's much more RANTes present in the myodine-treated cells versus the control cells, okay? So NF-kappa B went into the nucleus, and it's functioning as a transcription factor, okay? And this goes well with what we see in vivo. We can see phosphonucleotide NF-kappa B present in the nucleus of the fibroblasts, right? So we recapitulated in vitro what we see in vivo, and it's probably under the control of myodine, okay? So the question then is, well, we could skip that. It's interesting that, so this is a NF-kappa B reporter construct. Again, spawned into our myodine causes an increase in that reporter activity, suggesting that the spawned myodine activates NF-kappa B. And as I mentioned, the human disease of fibrosis in the skin is called scleroderma, or systemic sclerosis. And it's actually quite interesting because it's also been shown by Mike Whitfield, who's at Dartmouth, that a lot of the NF-kappa B target genes are also upregulated in the human disease. Okay, so we're getting close to a disease model using our mouse model here. So the same pathways that cause fibrosis in our snail transgenic mouse has been shown to be activated in the skin disease scleroderma.
Una delle ipotesi che abbiamo è legata al myodine che attiva l'NFK-beta nei fibroblasti contenuti all'interno della pelle. Quando trattiamo i fibroblasti con questa myodine vediamo uno spostamento, come possiamo vedere qui nell'immagine in alto, e quindi troviamo dei valori differenti. Abbiamo ricapitolato in vitro quello che è possibile vedere in vivo nell'immagine in basso. Abbiamo visto come la spondin 2 e la myodine attivano l'NFK beta all'interno dei fibroblasti, e abbiamo visto la presenza di diversi geni NFK beta, comparando l'attività che viene svolta con i topi transgenici a quello che in realtà si svolge all'interno del corpo umano.
Okay, so then the question is, what is actually myodine activating these fibroblasts to cause the inflammation? So this is basically our hypothetical model, is that snail-expressing keratinocytes secrete myodine that can activate these dermal fibroblasts and through subsequent steps lead to the secretion of pro-inflammatory cytokines. So to test this model, we asked, what if we remove myodine from the tissue? What would happen? Do we affect inflammation? So by blocking myodine, we would block this further downstream pathway. And what we did, this is not coming out very well. But anyway, forget that. We looked at the number of macrophages that are infiltrated in the snail transgenic skin. And this was the images of that. And you can see in the snail transgenic skin, there's about an sevenfold increase in the number of macrophages relative to wild type. Okay, and these macrophages are responsible for the inflammation. If you remove myodine from this mouse, you can substantially reduce the number of macrophages that have been infiltrated into the skin. Okay, and then it also has been shown that the epidermis is hyperplastic or thickened in the snail transgenic mouse. So in the wild type mouse, the epidermis is here. This white dotted line is the basement membrane that separates it from the dermis below. What you can see is that the epidermal thickening in the snail transgenic mouse is increased. If you look at the snail and the anti-inflammatory drugs, you can block this epidermal hyperplasia. So a lot of the phenotypes that we see in the snail transgenic mouse are due to that inflammation. So the question then is that, can the knockout of myndin substitute for this anti-inflammatory response? So, this is not coming out very well either. Okay, so basically what we did is we measured epidermal thickness in the wild type and
snail transgenic mouse. And again, the epidermis is thicker in the snail transgenic mouse. But if you remove myndin, you substantially reduce that epidermal thickness. So this, what we're trying to do is draw a parallel between inflammation. You can decrease inflammation by myndin. If you use chemicals to block inflammation, you can block this epidermal hyperplasia. But if we use myndin instead of anti-inflammatory drugs, you can also block this proliferation, suggesting that it's the keratinocytes secreting myndin that activate fibroblasts, and the fibroblasts can cause inflammation.
Abbiamo visto lo snail legato al myndin che a sua volta è legato ai fibroblasti. Cosa succede tuttavia se eleviamo il myndin? In realtà le immagini non si vedono molto bene, ma vediamo che nella pelle transgenica c'è una produzione molto alta di macrofagi che sono infiltrati all'interno della pelle. Nella slide precedente abbiamo parlato di immunosoppressione del modo in cui questa blocchi l'iperplasia epidermica. Abbiamo tentato di misurare lo spessore dell'epidermide, senza myndin in realtà questo spessore diminuisce. Lo utilizziamo c'è un blocco di proliferazione.
So this is why the use of these mouse models to find components is important, because you don't want to give anti-inflammatory drugs to someone with fibrosis because it also makes them susceptible to infection, right? So you don't want to give something systemically. And what I showed you in the previous data was that myndin is only turned on when snail is expressed. So if you could give anti-myndin therapies that have, what theoretically have less side effects than just giving a generic anti-inflammatory response. So the question then is that if we do block myndin, will it block this dermal thickening? And again, the reason why I'm talking about this is that it seems that myndin can lead to the infiltration of these various immune cells within the tissue, and it's well known, this has been published, that these immune cells can lead to the activation of the fibroblasts and ultimately fibrosis. So the question is, what if we remove this inflammation, right, by blocking myndin instead of just giving a generic anti-inflammatory drug? So does the dermal thickening, which is a measure of fibrosis, decrease? And in fact, it does. So again, this is dermal thickness. It's increased about threefold in the snail transgenic mouse. But if you remove myndin from the snail transgenic mouse, it decreases almost back to wild type levels. So altogether, what this data suggests is that snail promotes dermal fibroblast crosstalk through myndin. So we have keratinocytes that express snail, and when they express snail, they secrete myndin. And then myndin can actually activate these fibroblasts by NF-kappa-B, and this NF-kappa-B can then cause the infiltration of these inflammatory cells. Then these inflammatory cells work back onto the keratinocytes to cause the proliferation and migration. And by blocking this part of the pathway, we can prevent everything from downstream from happening. So the other thing that we see is that the inflammatory cells are also required for the increased expression of extracellular matrix protein, which is the cause of the thickening of the dermis. Again, if you block myndin, you can block these inflammatory cells, and you also block this from occurring. So what we found is one component secreted by snail that can block both inflammation and the downstream effects of it as a way of ameliorating the effect of fibrosis.
Quindi parlando sempre del myndin, vediamo che il
ci sono diversi esperimenti che abbiamo condotto e soprattutto sono stati condotti sul blocco del minding, quindi se blocchiamo in qualche modo questa sostanza vediamo delle differenze, ad esempio vediamo che lo spessore della pelle sia proprio assolutamente legato al minding. Lo snail promuove a sua volta il crosstalk dei fibroblasti e vediamo che in realtà se blocchiamo il minding blocchiamo anche le cellule infiammatorie.
Ok, so the other Oh, she needs a break.
Yeah. So okay. If you want, you can go on and...
No, no, we'll take a break. Huh?
If you want, you can go on. It's very technical for me.
So okay.
Half an hour.
Okay. Yeah, maybe I only have about 20 more minutes to go. Should I go or...? Just go? Okay. But he won't understand. Okay, you're not understanding anyway. I'll just go. Okay, so I talked about this spondin 2 protein. The next one I want to talk about, because I thought that a lot of people here who work on the engineering stuff, things, might be interested in fibrillin 5, because actually it's a way of incorporating mechanobiology into this process, okay? So basically, how does physical forces affect, or tissue rigidity affect the behavior of fibroblasts, okay? So we initially became interested because, I mean, I showed you this data where we have activated fibroblasts and increased dermal thickening. So what we did in collaboration with a colleague of mine at UC San Diego was we just took the skin and did stress strain measurements, right? Because fibrosis is known to give hardened skin. So one measure of testing whether snail is a fibrotic model is does the skin harden? So here is the wild type skin, and you can see that the snail transgenic skin has a higher stress strain modulus relative to its wild type control. So that's the wild type and that's the snail transgenic. And then so we could measure, look at the modulus at the low and high strain levels. And so we looked at this strain at the 0 to 0.1 range, and we saw this range measures the tangential modulus for elastin at the lower strain. And you can see that the elastin fibers are higher in the snail transgenic mouse, right? And again, we would not have known to look at this unless we did this stress strain curves, okay? And then this is not coming out very well, but if we stain for elastic fibers using this Giessen stain, there's much more elastin in the snail transgenic mouse relative to the wild type. Okay, so this is an example by which physical characterization of the tissue can give you some insights onto the biochemical underpinnings of how this is happening. So this is at the low strain. What about this higher strain where you have more of a difference? So at this higher strain, you get this tangential modulus measures the effect of collagen, okay? And again, this is higher in the snail transgenic. And I told you, we already knew this part here, that there was more collagen in the snail transgenic, but it was verified actually by looking at the modulus at the higher strain. Okay, so what the question that we had is that one of the proteins we found was fibrillin 5, which is an extracellular matrix protein that can bind to elastic fibers. So we're asking, is that protein responsible for this kind of a strain? So, okay, this is not coming out very well, but we stain for fibrillin 5 in the dermis, and the keratin 5 marks the epidermis. And basically what you should see here is that there's more fibrillin 5 expression in the snail transgenic skin versus the wild type skin. And if we quantify that, there's a significant increase in the amount of fibrillin 5 in the snail transgenic skin versus the wild type skin. And fibrillin 5 is actually kind of important. So what fibrillin 5 does is it takes these microfibril bundles and it binds to these fibrils and also recruits elastin to these microfibers to make lead to the formation of these mature elastic fibers. So it's required for the biogenesis of these elastic fibers. So the question then is, can we target this fibrillin 5 to block this elastin fiber formation and the fibrotic phenotype that we see in the tissue? So that's what we did, is that we have a wild-type mouse, a fibrillin 5 knockout mouse, the snail transgenic mouse, and a snail transgenic mouse also lacking fibrillin 5, okay? And then what you can see here is that there's an increase in the elastin content in the snail transgenic mouse, but when you remove fibrillin 5, the elastin content goes back to wild-type levels. And this can be reflected at the stress strain curve because it also, the snail transgenic mouse has a higher tangential modulus at the lower strain, and this can be reduced to even below wild type levels when the snail transgenic mouse lacks fibrillin 5. Okay, so the tissue, at least at the low modulus, can be reversed by removing fibrillin 5. And actually, this is quite specific for the elastin elastic fibers because it has no effect on collagen. So you can see that the snail transgenic has significantly higher collagen contents, but removing fibrillin 5 does not block the collagen. It only blocks the elastin. And again, you can measure this at the stress strain curve. There's no effect on the collagen stress strain, only on the strain due to elastin. Okay, so we got a relatively specific protein that can affect the elastin one. And this is actually quite important because people have been trying to target collagen in fibrotic diseases, right? But collagen, as I mentioned, is 25 to 35% of your entire protein content of the body. When you start messing up with collagen, the tissue kind of basically dissolves, right? So we want something that's a little more focused and not so prevalent. That way we can don't affect the normal homeostasis of the tissue. Okay, so that's why we think this fibrillin 5 is actually quite important, because again, it affects only the elastin, but not the collagen contribution. So in the spondin 2, I told you that if you block inflammation, you can block the fibrotic phenotype, right? So the dermal thickening, the epidermal hyperplasia, a lot of the phenotypes go away when you block inflammation. Can fibrillin 5 also block inflammation, play a role in the inflammatory response? So remember, dermal thickness is our measure of fibrosis. So the thicker the dermis, the more fibrotic it is. In the snail transgenic mouse, there's an increase in dermal thickening that's significant. And again, when you block fibrillin 5, you can bring it almost back to wild-type levels. Okay, so removing one component of the elastic fibers assembly can, to a large extent, remove the fibrotic phenotype. And so we asked then, okay, what happens if we block inflammation? So we did it chemically. So what happens here is that you have the snail transgenic mouse, and we measure the dermal thickness, which is our measure of fibrosis. And again, the dermal thickness is higher in the snail transgenic mouse treated with vehicle control. If we treat with clobetasol, which is an anti-inflammatory drug that's a component in many drugs, you can block that dermal fibrosis. Okay, and again, but I told you that, you know, in general, it's not clinically suggested that you give systemic anti-inflammatory drugs, because then you also make the patient more susceptible to infection. So again, we want more targeted approach. The question is, can the knockout of fibrillin 5 function the same as blocking inflammation here? And so that's what we tested. So we looked for macrophages and T cells in wild type, snail transgenic skin, and snail transgenic skin treated also lacking fibrillin 5. And it's not coming out very good here, but it's quantified here. And you can see that there's a marked increase in the amount of immune cells in the snail transgenic skin, either macrophages or T cells. And this is substantially reduced in the fibrillin 5 knockout. Okay. Now, it's important here is that it doesn't reduce it to wild-type levels, right? But the dermal thickening is less, right? You can remove fibrosis without completely blocking the inflammatory response. And that actually was actually quite interesting to us, because then we asked, then how can fibrinolipin 5 regulate this inflammatory response? And that gets me back to this activated fibroblast business, right? So these activated fibroblasts can talk to either tumor cells or regular epithelial cells. They can talk to inflammatory cells. They can talk to the endothelial cells in your blood vessels, and they can also cause the over-secretion or regulate the amount of extracellular matrix, right? So these guys seem to be at the center of attention. So the question that we had is, and there's actually crosstalk going both ways between these different structures. So the question that we had is this fibrinolipin 5, which is an ECM component, working back on these activated fibroblasts and thereby affecting this inflammation, right? So you've seen some type of a network here. And I told you that the myndin, which is secreted from the snail-expressing keratinocytes, can activate these fibroblasts and then cause inflammation, right? And so that's why this became actually kind of interesting, and it worked out well, because we removed only one component, fibrinolipin 5, but we didn't completely block inflammation, because myndin is still present and can, like I showed you the data, can still cause some level of an inflammatory response. And what we're seeing is that the components are working in concert with each other. They're working together to raise the level of inflammation to a threshold where you will get dermal fibrosis, right? So you could get inflammation, and you guys get inflammation all the time, but you don't get fibrosis, right? So there is a critical level that you need to achieve in order to get the fibrosis. So myndin is one component, but it's possible that the fibrinolipin 5 adds to that inflammatory response to bring it up to a level that will actually lead to disease. So the question then is, how does it do it? So the hypothesis is that fibrinolipin 5, which is an ECM binding protein, can it work backwards on these fibroblasts and then also affect the inflammation? So we tested this hypothesis, is that we asked to see if the fibrinolipin 5 can activate these dermal fibroblasts. So I remember, we always go back to this smooth muscle actin is our marker of fibroblast activation. And again, fibrinolipin 5 is an ECM protein. So in the snail transgenic mouse, you see a lot more activated fibroblasts. In the absence of fibrinolipin 5, you see some activated fibroblasts, but not as much as the snail transgenic mouse. So again, it doesn't completely abolish the activation, it just dampens the activation of this these fibroblasts. And this can be seen at the gene expression levels, where you look at smooth muscle actin, connective tissue growth factor, which we these genes of activated fibroblasts, and another one is called SPARC. So the important ones are this, here is the wild type, snail transgenic. They're always higher in the snail transgenic mouse. If you remove fibrinolipin 5 from the snail transgenic mouse, you substantially reduce it, but not all the way back to wild type levels. Again, so again, we're dampening the system by just removing the fibrinolipin 5. So this suggests then that the fibrinolipin 5 can play a role in raising the activation of these fibroblasts. But what about this pathway now? So can it go this way? So if we decrease the activation of these fibroblasts, can we mute some of these inflammatory cytokines? And then so we looked at different inflammatory cytokine expression. And again, the important one is this blue and red. You see marked increase in inflammatory cytokines in the snail transgenic mouse. And all of them are substantially reduced when you remove fibrinolipin 5. Okay? But again, you're not completely blocking it to wild-type levels. So what this suggests is a model whereby snail can secrete myndin. Myndin can activate these fibroblasts to induce an inflammatory response and an increase in the extracellular matrix, right? The dermal thickening that you see. But this extracellular matrix can also feed back on these fibroblasts to accentuate this inflammatory response to bring it to a level that is required to get fibrosis. Okay, so again, this fibrosis is a multi-component process, and blocking individual components to some extent can determine whether or not you reach that threshold where disease will occur. Okay, so The question that we have now is that for some reason, fibrin 5, which increases the elastic modulus, is somehow causing inflammation. How is an ECM protein affecting this fibroblast leading to inflammation? Right? That seems strange. And just look at his face, he's confused. Okay, so the question, so what's becoming popular nowadays is, again, this idea of mechanobiology, right? How does substrate rigidity or tissue tension affect the behavior of the cells that are embedded within the ECM? And it's actually known that, I mean, if you plate your fibroblasts on a tissue culture plate, they're more active than a cell on a soft matrix, right? So just plating cells on a soft, on a hard matrix can hyperactivate them, okay? So then we ask this question then, are these fibroblasts susceptible to changes, small changes in the rigidity of the substrate, okay? Because I showed you that fibrin 5 can increase the elastin modulus. So we tested this experiment by plating cells on a soft and a slightly harder matrix. So just a 2 kilopascal difference in the rigidity of the substrate was tested. And then I told you that myndin can activate the system, right, and is required, but then what is the contribution of this substrate rigidity that is increased because of fibrin 5? So if we just take a look at the 2 kilopascals, you can see that myndin treatment increases the expression of these inflammatory cytokines. If you just do the same experiment on a slightly harder matrix, you can accentuate the inflammatory response more on a slightly harder matrix than you do on a softer matrix, right? So the idea then that emerges from this study is that you have soluble proteins that can activate the process, but the change in the extracellular matrix in the microenvironment can feed back and raise it to a level that crosses the threshold where disease becomes possible. Okay, so it's a contribution of both soluble as well as extracellular matrix proteins that work together in order to cause disease. So the summary of all this talks is that the snail transgenic skin is a model for tissue or tumor fibrosis. The elastin binding protein, fibrin 5, is elevated in the transgenic dermis. And deletion of fibrin 5 decreases elastin, but collagen remains elevated. Even though collagen is elevated, its dermal thickness and corresponding tissue stiffness is actually decreased substantially, right? And deletion of fibrin 5 decreases inflammation in the fibrotic skin. And it's possible it's done through the fact that small increases in the substrate rigidity due to fibrin 5 is able to enhance the inflammatory response in dermal fibroblasts and thereby promote disease such as fibrosis. And I've been told that I'm not showing any of the people who are doing this work, so I'll show now. So a lot of the fibrin 5 work was done by a postdoc who's actually still in San Diego in my lab there, Manando Nakasaki. And it was originally started by another postdoc, Tuanlin Tan, who now has his own lab in Singapore. And these are the people in India who are now continuing this work. And this is the funding agencies, the Dermatology Foundation, the American Cancer Society, EFOM, which I'm now associated with, the NIH and INSTEM are also providing funding. The measurements of the tissue rigidity and the substrate rigidity has been done in collaboration with my colleague at UCSD, Shiny Varghese, and in particular her postdoc, Joshua. And the work with fibrin 5 is done in collaboration with Professor Nakamura in Japan. And the mass spec data that gave me all these proteins to work with was done in collaboration with my colleague, Steve Briggs. And I think we'll break for lunch if there's no questions. This summary? Yeah, sure. Translation.
Assunto finale? O è chiaro per tutti? È chiaro? Ok. E alla fine c'erano i ringraziamenti, quindi tutti gli istituti con cui collabora e le persone con cui collabora che ha voluto ringraziare.
What? What happened?
It happens that they don't want the translation.
Okay. Fine. Okay.
quindi possiamo fermarci per una pausa pranzo.